Maine. And we lobby every single day right here because we believe that women should live lives free from violence, free from sexual assault, free from discrimination, with access to the full range of health care, and we mean reproductive health care.
Yeah.
And we know that women need economic security.
Yeah.
And when we talk about economic security, we're talking about good wages, about health care, about affordable child care so you can work knowing your child is safe, about the ability to have paid family leave so you can take time off when you have a baby or you need to care for an ailing family member, and the ability to earn paid sick days so that you can stay home when you're sick or your kid is sick and not have to choose between that or buying groceries that week. I would rather be this morning than right here with all of you. That's because I know, and you know, that we can build the state, the nation, the society where we want to live. We can do it. We can do it. I want to live where everyone can rise to their absolute full potential because they have a good education and they have health care.
Yeah!
Yeah!
I want to live where we all, not only enjoy equal protection under the law without regard to race, color, sex, sexual orientation, religion, age, physical or mental ability, ancestry or national origin or gender identity. But also where we are all valued as human beings.
Yes.
And where we treat one another with respect and with kindness. I want to live in a place where we know that climate change is real. And that we recognize that it is one of the underlying factors in the world's humanitarian crisis today. And we do something about it. I want to live where we offer safe harbor to people who are fleeing violence and rape and oppression and torture and hunger.
Yeah.
I want to live in a place where we recognize that every single person has worth and can contribute to our society. Now the state senator from Kennebec County, Senator Shenabellos.
To be here today with you. Yesterday, a friend asked me whether it could be a march if we weren't walking. And I thought about it for a minute, looked it up in the dictionary. Here's what I found. March, to move in a direct, purposeful manner. So yes, this is a march. Moving forward, and our purpose is clear. Women's rights are human rights. Right. Human rights are women's rights. Our march is righteous. It is a march for unity in a time of division. It is a march for hope in a time of fear. It is a march for faith in a time of doubt. So thank you, each one of you, for having the courage and determination to come here this morning. As we move forward over the next year and the next decade to make positive change in our world, there are three principles embodied here at this gathering today that we must hold on to. First is courage. A lot of folks in this crowd are feeling angry or anxious or fearful about the future. As one friend told me yesterday, my fight or flight instinct is in overdrive. I'm sure many of you feel the same way, and it's okay. You are not alone. We are not alone. You see, courage is not the absence of fear or anxiety. It is action, the will to move forward in spite of our fears. Having courage would be easy if we knew that courage was all that it took to win. But sometimes loss takes even more courage than victory. We must have the courage to lose and to persevere in the face of that loss. And when we look at the history of human rights in this country, it is a tragic history full of deep loss, and yet we have made progress. We are a more just and equal society than we were when our nation was founded. We are more just and equal than we were even 50 years ago. And defending these human rights will require every single one of us to have courage, even when it feels like we are losing the things that we hold most dear. Even when it really, really hurts, we have to stay engaged and continue to advocate. We must hold fast to our courage. The second principle is solidarity. Our movement has grown and will continue to grow to be more inclusive of people of color, of people with disabilities and all abilities, of new Americans and immigrants from all around the world, of lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer people, of people of all faiths, including the people who have been most targeted in recent days, our Jewish and Muslim brothers and sisters.
Yes.
As we make our movement more inclusive and strive to be fully inclusive and understand what that means, we must grow our hearts and open our minds to love our neighbors as ourselves, to give full meaning to equality and justice for all within this fractured but beloved community that is the United States of America. So as we move forward, let's move forward in solidarity.
Yes.
Third is to remember that the real power lies in your hands. The real power lies with the people. Today's march in Maine started with a group of women, none of whom had held elected office, none of whose names are in the papers every day, at least not until this week. You may or may not know Alicia, Ariel, Becca, Jessica, Megan, or Stephanie. But they are the amazing organizers of today's event.
Yeah!
And what makes them special is that they made a decision to act. All great movements in our country, and indeed around the world, have started with the people, were nourished by the people, succeeded because of the people. The women's movement, the civil rights movement, the reproductive justice movement, the disability rights movement, the marriage equality movement, and most recent of all, Standing Rock. These...
Yeah! Yeah!
All of these powerful movements for change that have helped make our country a more just and equal place began with the people. All of them relied not on politicians or celebrities, but regular people. We cannot wait for one perfect leader to save our future. Saving our future starts with us here today. So that means calling your elected elected officials in Washington and Augusta every week until we are heard. It means clicking on all of those action alerts, or better yet, sharing your personal story in an individual email. It means showing up at a public hearing or at a public event where there will be an elected official to ask those difficult questions and make your voices heard. Your voice matters. Your power is real. It is the people who do not make the history books who, working together, make the history. You have the power to make a difference in this world. Use your power, show solidarity, have courage. That's what will move us forward today and tomorrow and the next day and the next. Thank you so much for making history today. Yeah.
No matter who is in Washington, no matter who is in Augusta, no matter who is on the Supreme Court, we Americans will always be united by unbreakable values that are part of our common DNA. Fairness, justice, equality, and the responsibility we have to build a better future and a better world for our children. Now the poet Mary Oliver asks us, tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? Your one wild and precious life. Implied in her words is that we don't have much time here. We are precious, but we are also tough. You are here because your wild and precious life calls you to be together with your fellow Maine sisters and brothers to fight for the values we share. Now I am here to ask you, will you head into the arena and fight? Yeah! Are the Maine fighters, and I know we'll always be on the front lines for our kids, for our environment, and for our way of life. Thank you.
Inclusion is a big part of our movement because we are at our strongest when we unify and we support each other. Not just our transgender sisters, but all minority women living in the United States. Immigrants, refugees, Muslims, Syrians, Middle Eastern women are all facing fierce opposition right now. I was asked to represent the transgender community today because I went through a traumatic experience because of who I am. Some of you may know my story, but I would like to share it briefly for those of you who do not. You see, I learned something from what I went through. I was a victim, but I will not continue to be one. I lived through an assault to tell the world what is happening, what we are facing. I was told by someone close to me, it is something that happened to me, but it is not who I am. Therefore, I came to a place where I could flourish, do all the things in life that a person should do, without having the word transgender define who I am and limit my opportunities. So I moved from Arkansas to Maine. I was beaten so badly that it almost cost me my life. I survived my attack, but was left with an endless list of medical bills. I was blamed for what happened to me. I faced rejection everywhere I turned. I heard things like, transgender, what is that? I was told by an attorney, you might as well be a Martian. Nobody is going to understand. I was told that a jury in Arkansas was not going to be on my side, and I was led to believe that it was my fault for being present at the place where it happened. It happened at a Christmas party, my company Christmas party, by my coworkers, people that I had known for 4 years. I was refused assistance from my local police department and driven into seclusion, afraid to talk about what I went through. I lived with this silently for several months. When I was finally able to build the courage up to come forth with my story, I was met by community members They shamed me. They said things like, how dare you? How dare you damage the reputation of these good people? These people that would never hurt anybody. I was addressed with all male pronouns from the police department. One of the easiest ways for my community to brush this under the rug was to say that some men beat up another man. But I am not a man. What I and my family went through is unfathomable, and yet I know exactly how it feels to be targeted, to be blamed for what happened, to be shamed for speaking up. All of this because it hurt the reputation of those that hurt me. When you survive something as traumatic as what I went through, the last thing you want to experience is being the bad person just for speaking. This is why so many victims of violent crimes and sexual assaults never come forward. A staggering portion of the transgender people face exactly what I went through. Some are not as lucky as I was. A lot of us lose our lives each year. Transgender women of color face the worst odds, with a 1 in 8% chance of being murdered. More often than not, our attackers get a slap on the wrist or go free. The charges are never taken seriously because the legal system and society views the victim as a male, and they often empathize with the attacker. We face a world and a political system that tells us we do not have the right to exist. Yet here I am.
Yeah!
Here we are. Not backing down. The world is not fair, it is not just, yet we smile and face each day. We put our best foot forward and strive to be better than the day before, while constantly standing against lawmakers and politicians that will deny us access to health care, equal employment opportunities, and the basic right to exist without discrimination and harassment. I am here today to ask that all of you come together, continue to include all women, all feminine identifying people. Stay diligent in the fight for equality. Remain positive. We face a lot of work in the next 4 years. We will face some of the strongest opposition we have seen. This is not the time to be divided because of our individual beliefs. This is not the time to react out of fear or anger. This is the time to be organized and stand together. So many are counting on us. Each and every one of you here today to remember is that you have a voice, and it matters. You are the center of this movement. I know that each and every one of you here today has a story to tell, an opinion, or an idea on how we can create the change that the world needs. I'm asking you to be the change that the world needs. Peacefully and compassionately, even the smallest ripples grow in the waves. You can create the dialogue that gets people discussing, learning, and growing. I hope that sharing my story here today shines some light on some very real and serious issues we face, and that working together we can stop it from happening again. Thank you for having me.
Yeah! I want to talk a little bit about my journey and how courage comes with me. I am from Somalia.
Sorry.
I'm the oldest of 13 children. To be a person who has been displaced, pick up the pieces,
displaced,
and move on as if life is normal. And then, United States represents safety, hope, prosperity, and a bright future. A future that is very inclusive of all. Yet, we have a very long way to go, because that future, that bright light at the end of the tunnel, is threatened by a few.
I'm here, Doug.
You see, if collectively we all work together in little ways, in big ways, in every day, that little, you know, those few people who intimidate us, who create a lot of fear, who think they can dictate to us, imagine the power we will have to overturn their fear.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I came to the state of Maine, 15 years ago. I came to Lewiston. We only had 3 Somali families in Lewiston at the time. Today, the demographics of the state of Maine has changed some 30 years ago, whether we liked it or not.
Like it.
I know, there are people who still say, where are you from? Why are you here? And what I say to them is, you need people like me. Of the state of Maine. We are the state. So I think, you know, the word courage has a huge meaning to me. It's the idea that you can defy the odds, you can stand up. Yes, sometimes I cry. And yes, sometimes it feels very lonely. And yes, sometimes I don't look like the majority of the people who are here, but I am such a beautiful, smart, colorful, young woman.
Yeah.
The idea that I will come to the state of Maine some 15 years ago, not knowing what this state could provide to me and my children. And today I have 2 young girls, one in Georgetown University and one in Swarthmore. That is the courage that we have. That is the hope that we have. That is our future. My daughter is actually at the march in Washington, D.C., both of them. I brought my other daughter here so that she can see what the world can offer her. So that she doesn't get bogged down every day to be told, you don't deserve this. You don't deserve freedom. You don't deserve education. You don't deserve the ideal life that anybody can have. You can't be your potential. That is the messages we keep hearing. What we need to do is, we collectively, each of us, have the courage in us, whether it's small or big. We have the responsibility that we owe to ourselves and to the many generations to come. We have the responsibility to stand up for the vulnerable. We have the responsibility to not be the silent majority. We can afford that today. We can afford that tomorrow. This is the time that we need to stand up. I know I only have 5 minutes. I don't have much time. I am very fortunate to be in front of you, to be an immigrant that has the opportunities I have today. As we stand here There are many immigrants in the world that have been displaced. Many children and women who have no shelter, no hope, no place to turn to. They don't have a second chance like I've had. They don't have the opportunity to go to school. They don't have communities. They don't have schools. They don't have a home to go to. That's the place we come from. America represents the opposite of all of that.
Hey everyone, I'm getting ready to actually go to a Dungeons & Dragons meetup with my friends, but I just wanted to talk to you guys about the video that I posted. There were so many amazing speakers, and I really felt as though I needed to say something about the video. Originally, I didn't think it was going to be this big, but it ended up having a really amazing crowd. I mean, the people were great. And the speakers that they had were so amazing. It really opened my eyes that, you know, it helped me realize that the things that I do can make a difference. And that everything that we do, when we go to these events and these rallies and these marches, they make a difference. When people watch this on the TV, they have hope again. I think it's a really amazing feeling that I have being a part of this. Just being a part of history with all of you amazing people. To be able to give my friends and my family who felt like they didn't have anything to hope for when, you know, all of this hate is just, it's running rampant, and it's a really good feeling to realize that this isn't going unchecked. That there are people fighting for your rights, for my rights, for our rights to exist. It's so important to be a part of that, and I'm honored to say that I was there, and that I was there for you, for my family and my friends. Anyways, I just wanted to say thank you for the opportunity. I'm so grateful to be alive and to be able to be that change that I wish to see. I encourage all of you, all of everyone, to just be that change. Right now, we have to become the hope we so desperately seek. So, thank you guys.